Hey, we're going to go ahead and get started. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this intimate gathering. Thanks for being here today. My name is Mike Hotchkiss with Hotchkiss Insurance, and I'm very happy to welcome you to this general session and honored to be the sponsor. For more than 40 years, Hotchkiss Insurance has served as a trusted insurance solution provider for businesses, associations, and individuals across Texas. At Hotchkiss, our purpose is to provide protection in a world of unknowns. And we do this so our clients can fulfill and achieve their own purposes. So we appreciate your business and we look forward to serving you in the future. So speaking of unknowns, there's a subject that we all need to learn more about, and it's the technology that's all around us and the dangers surrounding that. So my cell phone, 10 years ago, I couldn't have imagined how much of my life would be intertwined in this tiny, powerful device, right? Today's world is interconnected more than ever before, but for all its advantages, increased connectivity brings increased risk of theft, fraud, and abuse. As the number of mobile users, digital applications, and data networks grow, so do the opportunities for cybercriminals to invade our lives. With the escalating volume and sophistication of cyber attacks, ongoing vigilance is necessary to protect sensitive businesses and personal information, as well as safeguard our national security. We're fortunate to have with us today Tim Medin, a senior technical analyst at CounterHack, a company focused on security consulting and the development of information security challenges for education, evaluation, and competition. Through the course of his career, Tim has performed penetration tests, that means like legal hacking, on a wide range of organizations and technologies. At CounterHack, one of his major focuses has been on NetWars, a hacking tool and game used by thousands of security professionals around the world. Prior to CounterHack, Tim was a senior security consultant for the world's largest security firm, where the majority of his focus was on penetration testing. He has information security experience in a variety of industries, including control systems, higher education, financial services, and manufacturing. Tim has spoken at numerous security conferences, provided training around the world, and has been interviewed and quoted in multiple national media outlets. He's also a certified instructor for the SANS Institute, where he teaches penetration testing to government and private sector security professionals. So he's not only a hacker, he's a hacker teacher, right? So please join me in welcoming Tim Medin.
Thank you, sir. Thank you guys for coming. I know you guys have had a long day. How many of you guys were presenters downstairs, out of curiosity? No? Did you ditch the rest of the guys? Are they cleaning up for you? Yeah? All right. Well done. All right, cool. Thank you guys so much for coming this evening. I'm going to go through some of the topics. A couple of little bit of backstory on me. Penetration testing, again, that's the term we use for ethical hacking. That's my day job, which is really kind of awkward when I get on a plane. You know, the first thing we Americans say to each other, like, hey, how's it going? What's your name? What do you do? And if I throw out, I'm a hacker, you know, conversation gets really weird. If there's a woman next to me and I'm not paying attention, I say I'm a penetration tester, she thinks it's like a really bad pickup line. It gets really, really awkward. Yeah, I'm like, no. But that me, good luck, right? Enjoy where you're landing. I also teach with SANS as well. Some of the personal things that I like to do, I do a lot of hacking, okay? There's a lot of what we call capture the flags. How many of you played capture the flags as kids, right? Well, we have a lot of challenges in our hacking conferences and such where we do a capture the flag. You plant a flag on these various systems, and the goal of the various teams is to hack into these systems and grab the flags. In fact, I'm on a team, that's our team logo there, Shellfish with a PH. I'll talk about a little bit about some of the culture related to that as well. I like to break things, and I work from home. Dressing up and wearing pants is awful. I don't know how you guys do this every single day. It's terrible. And I guess it's no longer a secret, but I play some Pokemon Go. We were playing Pokemon Go back there for the last 20 minutes or so. All right, so first up, we're going to talk a little bit about the history. What is hacking? Okay, where did it come from? Because that's kind of important to understand a lot of the culture, a lot of the sort of the thought and idealism behind some of the people that are doing some of these hacks, both the good guys and the bad guys. We'll walk you through a little bit of what's going on these days and, frankly, what you can do to protect yourself, because that's sort of the ultimate goal here, right? Now, hopefully you guys will leave here with some better tips, tricks, and techniques to make you, your family, your kids, your business a little bit more secure. So here's a little bit of the history of hacking. So off to the far left, hacking initially, the term was a positive thing. It was a term given to someone who showed technical prowess. It was originally coined by the MIT in their Tech Model Railroad Club and the AI lab at MIT. And if you were a hacker, it was a badge you wore honorably. In the 70s, we moved on to a lot of phone phreaking. That was sort of the original sort of hacks, if you will. Arguable whether it was sort of malicious or not, the guys who were doing the phone phreaking didn't mean so. What they would do is they would get on the big trunk lines by the various phone companies, and they would talk to people all over the world. And they would literally have some conversations about themselves, but a lot of it surrounded about the technology. Hey, how did you do this? When I get access to this device, what do I do? And they were working, learning the systems. A lot of it's just simply exploration. What can this thing do? What can I play with? What can I get access to? It wasn't actually breaking anything. Captain Crunch is one of our most famous hackers. He got his name from the toy in a Captain Crunch box. In the 60s, there was a whistle. You could get, if you know, you dig through the crappy Captain Crunch, you get the little toy at the bottom, and it was a whistle. If you blew that whistle blew at 2600 hertz. If you blew that whistle into a phone, the phone would say, "Oh, I've got the tone from the phone that says somebody has paid." So you go in, you whistle, dial whatever number you want. Captain Crunch figured that out, and he could whistle at 2600 hertz. So instead of carrying his thing around, he'd go up to the phone, go, he can't whistle very well. And then the phone would say, "Oh yeah, you're clear to make a phone call." The guy is absolutely crazy. I literally think he lives under a bridge these days. Really interesting fellow, albeit a little bit off. In the early 80s, this is where the hacking that we're associated with in the media today, this is where it begins. This is where we have our first break-ins. So we've got like 60 break-ins over in the early 80s. Not a huge amount of theft, but there is a little bit. We also get two big hacking groups. So we get the Legion of Doom and the Chaos Computing Club, CCC, out of Germany, who start up. In the late 80s, this is sort of when the landscape starts to change. Okay, so we get the CFAA, the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. This is the law that makes hacking illegal. Unauthorized access to a computer system used for interstate commercial money transactions, I forget the exact terminology, and it has to be over $5,000 worth of damage. So originally, there's protected computer systems were meant for banks, computer talking to another computer. But any of you guys buy anything online? Congratulations, interstate transactions right there. You now fall under the CFAA, and it's been enforced that way since then. So a lot of the people that get arrested for some of these violations, it's under the CFAA. And we start to see things like Kevin Mitnick. Have you guys heard the name Kevin Mitnick before? He's arrested the first time in the 80s. He breaks into MCI. He's what we call a social engineer. He's very good at talking to people, convincing them that he's supposed to be there and extracting information from them. So he would call up the MCI guys and say, "Hey, I got this trunk over here. It's not working. What's the access code to do blah, 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 blah?" And they'd give it to him. And then he'd use that to ask something else. He literally went into an MCI office, convinced him he was supposed to be there and started photocopying the manual for some of these devices. Pretty bold guy, right? We also see the first worms. We had the Morris worm come along those days. $70 million heist. In the 90s, some of the culture comes. We have DEF CON. So there's a lot of conferences. In fact, after this talk, I hop on an airplane. I'm going to Vegas to DEF CON. I'll talk a little bit about DEF CON here in a little bit. We get our movies like The Net, Hackers, Sneakers, etc. We get the Loft guys. This is the Loft guys. We call this the Hacker Last Supper. Right? This is Loft talking to Congress about how in 30 minutes or less they could shut down the entire internet. My favorite thing is, you can't really read it, but their nameplates in front of them. On the far left, we have Brian. What's Brian's last name? It's Brian Oblivion. Next to him is Tan. Next to him is, we've got Mudge in the middle, Weld Pond, Space Rogue, and Stefan von Neumann. But these guys were in front of Congress with their hacker names on the nameplates. I don't know about you, but I think that's pretty freaking cool. That's awesome to me. Right? I mean, who shows up at Congress and be like, yeah, call me Space Rogue? Right? So these guys show up. It kind of becomes a little bit more of the forefront, cybersecurity. Mitnick is arrested again. They put him in solitary confinement this time because they literally think he can pick up a phone and whistle the nuclear launch codes and start an international incident. True story. He's in solitary confinement for over a year because they think he can whistle the launch codes. Yeah, he can't. At least he says he can't. Then the 90s, the 2000s, we get the Trusting Computer Group, we get Anonymous. You guys are probably all familiar with that, and Stuxnet. Stuxnet was a big game changer. We have started having state actors actively hacking each other. All right? This is what we see in the media. You hear the term hacker, you get this, right? I'm sorry I left my hoodie at home. You know, all my balaclavas were dirty, right? So this is what we see, right? It's always the bad guy. I mean, all the hackers that I know, I mean, if you'd hacked like, I have a laser on here. There's a guy in like the second row all hunched over. You'd have like back problems. Any of you guys ever try to hack in a mask or use your computer in a mask? It doesn't really work. Right, but there's this negative association with hacking. But it's actually so much bigger. There's an entire culture surrounding that. So we'll have things like, we've got sort of this spectrum. We have our black cats. This is what we see big in the news, right? These are the bad guys. They're breaking into banks. They're stealing information. They're taking down websites. And on the other side, we've got the white hats. And this is taken from the old Westerns, right? You got the Westerns. The good guy always wore the white hat. The bad guy always wore the black hat. You knew who was good and bad, right? So I like to consider myself one of the white hats. I'm working to try to make us better, to defend against these black hats. But there's some sort of gray areas, right? Nothing in life is completely black or white, is it? There's gray areas. So technically, according to the law, unauthorized access to a computer system is a felony. If I am legally browsing a site, I happen to put in like a weird character, I figure out that there's something wrong with the website, technically I am in violation of the law. And a lot of times what I'll do is I'll call them up and say, hey, I found this particular issue. Can you guys fix it? It gets a little bit fuzzy in the middle, right? I have a friend of mine, Josh Wright, literally one of the best wireless guys on the face of the planet. He finds a problem with one of the Cisco devices. He can break the authentication for all the Cisco devices on the face of the planet for wireless authentication. And he wants to let the world know that there's a problem so that they can fix it, use something else. So he talks to Cisco. Cisco says, you can't talk about that anymore. We're going to sue you off the face of the planet. So like ninja lawyers like show up at his house one day, and he gets cease and desist. You can't tell anybody about this. The trade-off there is it making us more secure by Cisco doing this? No. Right? I mean, I just don't know how insecure I am. So he basically dumps it on the face of the planet and says, here it is. It's out there. Let people fix it. If you want to sue me, sue me. Let's dance. And once it gets out, you know, it's already out, right? We have some other situations like where we're looking at some software. We had another big one with Apple and the iPad. You guys remember when the iPads first came out? Right? It was a huge thing. Everyone to rush out and get the iPads. You could get in a queue for AT&T to sign up for the iPad or Best Buy, whatever. And Best Buy had like a list, a waiting list. You could sign up, hey, you want an iPad. Tim Medin, congratulations, you registered for your iPad. And the little top of the browser bar, it'd say like user ID equals 1002. And then somebody else would come along. Congratulations, Brian, you registered for the iPad. User ID, 1003. So what this guy did, Weave, he went through and said, well, what happens if I change it to 9999? Okay, congratulations, Kevin. It was some other user. And what he did is he wrote a little script that would just grab all of the people to register and get an iPad. Frankly, technically unauthorized access to a computer system. He was tried and convicted for that. He tried to communicate to them that there was an issue, but technically unauthorized access. So things get a little bit hairy. On top of that, we also have with our software end user license agreements. Right? You guys, anybody ever read one of those things? Yeah, no, right? You're like, you can't click fast enough. You're like, next, 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 next. Make the buttons go away, right? Make this thing work as fast as possible. Next, 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 done. Technically, if you violate the EULA, you might be in violation of the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. Because it's unauthorized access to the system or software, and if you violate that, technically you could be convicted under the CFAA. It hasn't happened yet. There's no precedent one way or another, but it's interesting to say what happens, right? Especially if some sort of big player with big, heavy, expensive lawyers gets on the EULA side, right? So there's this sort of a range in hacking. The culture, originally this sort of came about, the hacking culture is all about sharing. They want all the information to be free to a point where people sometimes aren't comfortable with that. They want to know, hey, how does this particular product work? What can I do with it? Can I break it? Can I manipulate it? Can I make it do something that it's not supposed to do? So we'll do this with software. We'll see this with our hardware as well. One of the RFCs, so all of the specifications for the internet are written in what we call an RFC. It's a request for comments. So like the HTTP specification is RFC 881, I think, something like that. There's a spec for like hacking culture. A person who delights in having an intimate understanding of internal workings of a system. That's the definition of a hacker according to the same things that define the specifications for the internet. Kind of funny in itself there, right? So we'll see a lot of these conferences develop all around the world. The first one was DEF CON. Starts in 1993. A bunch of people show up in Vegas. DEF CON starts tomorrow morning. I'm catching a flight in about 3 hours to go to DEF CON. It is 20,000 hackers in Vegas for a weekend. All right, if you want to see some crazy stuff, join me this weekend, all right? It's definitely a little bit interesting, but we've got some really interesting talks that we'll see at these events. The interactions among the people is very different. You guys all have badges, right? And what's printed on your badge? Your name, where you work, and there's a little barcode where you can scan it, and your scan thing shows your name, your address, where you work, all sorts of information. Those two gentlemen right in the middle are wearing the badge for DEF CON. Actually, those are technically Uber badges because they won a very skilled contest, and it gets them in every single year for free. There are no names. It is cash only. There is no companies. There are some people that I've known for 15 years, I literally don't know their first name. That's how things work out there. It's weird because we want to share all this information, but people don't share that information at all. Pictures are forbidden. If you take pictures in there at all, you'll get kicked out. Very different feel, but the people are super friendly. Lots of different contests for hacking. One of my favorites is the Spot the Fed. If you spot a Fed, you get a free t-shirt. If you're a Fed, you get a shirt that says, I am the Fed. If you spot the Fed, you get a shirt that says, I spotted the Fed. It's sort of this whole subculture thing, if you can find one of the FBI agents, whatever. The talks each year, some sort of new product, device, whatever, will come out. And people will say, oh, here's how I hacked this device. Here's how I made it do this other specific thing. And sometimes people show up with lawsuits and say, yeah, you can't talk about that. They're like, yeah, good luck. Try to stop me. You don't know what my name is. I am Atlas. Find Atlas. Right? So we have this sort of interesting dynamic. Really cool talk. Some of it's really fun and interesting. On the right, there's a giant puzzle. There's all sorts of really fantastic, really complex contest. We have there's a puzzle. There's pieces within this puzzle. People spend like 56 hours trying to decode this thing. It's all kinds of crazy. All right. So we talked a little bit about the hackers, the evolution of the attacks, and what you guys are probably seeing as end users, right? So in 1971, we had our very first sort of virus, worm, if you will. It was Creeper. What Creeper would do is it would copy itself from system to system, and it would say, ha-ha, you've been creeped, catch me if you can. So then somebody else wrote Reaper, which would go around and find Creeper and get rid of it. It was sort of written as a joke. We had our first sort of virus, if you will, for our home PCs, was actually on an Apple device, Elk, for our Apple II. We had Brian worm for the IBM PCs a little bit later. We had our first huge worm called the Morris worm, written by one of the founders and authors of Linux. His son actually wrote the Morris worm, went to jail for it. We had the Melissa virus. Any of you guys remember the Melissa virus back in the olden days? Anybody remember what Melissa was named after? Stripper. Stripper he had the hots for, yeah, so he had nothing better to do, so he wrote malware that got in the whole world. We had some Nimda, Configgers a little bit more recently, and then the more recent stuff, what we're seeing is CryptoLocker, where we see ransomware. We'll talk about ransomware here in a little bit. So, to us, what kind of information do we want to protect? Right, I've got my personal information. That's important to me. I don't want all of my details getting out. My name, phone number, my kids' information, social security numbers. We've got healthcare information. I mean, this stuff is literally life and death, right? If I find out or I can hack into one of these systems and change someone's allergy information, literally life and death. There's some of the hardware that we've got available, like one of those, I don't know what those pump machines are called that they hang the little bags on. One of those devices has a wireless capability. And you can connect to it and do some diagnostics. You can also get what we call shell access to it, which means low-level access to the device. And what you could do is change the speed on the motor to high, low, high, low, high, low, do that about a dozen times, it creates an air bubble. So literally what a bad guy could do is walk through a hospital wing and literally have death follow him. But the problem is we get anybody talks about this stuff, they get sued. So we don't hear about a lot of these discussions. My son was born in 2012. The hospital at which he was born was breached, like within 2 weeks of him being born. He lost his social security numbers to bad guys before we even had it. True story. Because the hospital ended up getting his social security number, like some sort of electronic thing. We got it delivered to us afterwards. The bad guys had it before I did. Right? So the kid, his entire life is potential for identity fraud. We also have money, right? The bad guys like money. They have kids to feed. They like Bentleys. And we've lost in the last year, it was an estimated $3.5 to almost $6 billion lost to the bad guys. And that's theft as well as things like ransomware. All right, here's what the attacks look like. So we'll see a lot of it is the external attacker. This is what we're always scared of, right? The big bad guy with the hoodie and the mask, the external attacker. But a significant portion is that yellow. That yellow is the internal, which means somebody works at your company, they're not happy. They leave with your data. They go someplace else, walk out with your entire customer list. Do you guys see any sports fans in the room? Do you guys see the Cardinals hacking deal that was the Cardinals? Yeah. So the Cardinals and the Astros, he moved from one organization to another, logged into the old team's information, technically got the information on the sports team, caused a competitive advantage. He's going to jail for a couple of years. Insider threat, right? Someone who you trusted to have your data now has left with it. And that's a big threat. If you guys ever hear of Edward Snowden, That is a huge deal in my line of work. You've got someone trusted on the inside who is supposed to have access to the data, is supposed to be working for you, and they put it on a USB stick and walk out the door with it, right? Oops, wrong button. So what can you guys do to protect yourselves? That's the important piece here, right? So one of the fundamental things, and you've probably heard this a whole bunch. In fact, we were just talking about this in the back. We were talking about passwords. There's a couple of fundamental things. A longer password is better. Okay, because when I'm running tools to try and either guess your password or what's called cracking your password, it's a different way of guessing passwords, the longer makes it a little bit harder for me. Because if you're going to use a word in the dictionary, those dictionary words may be 8, 9 characters. If you start to put multiple words together, it takes more time and energy for the bad guy to figure it out. Another important thing is be unique. Use a unique password. If you use the same password all over the place, you're going to have a problem. Because bad guys will get it from one place, and they'll reuse it someplace else. Right? We talk about with recycling. What's the slogan they say with recycling? It's the 3 R's. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Passwords are the opposite. Don't reuse your passwords. Don't reduce the number you're using. Don't recycle them. Once you've used it, don't ever use it again. Now, that's hard, isn't it? I have a horrible memory. Absolutely terrible. So I use an application to keep track for me. We also see all sorts of craziness. You go to a website, or like, you need like 47 characters, 6 numbers, and like all of the special characters. But is that easy to remember? Like, okay, so I used my favorite sports team, and I think with the zeros or O's, or was it the I's or 1's? And it gets to be too difficult to remember. So here's a comic that we use all the time. You don't have to read all of it. It's some math and stuff. But the top left is one of the passwords we commonly see, right? This meets our complexity requirements, as we call it. It's got the uppercase. It's got lowercase, our special characters, and a number. But it's impossible to remember, isn't it? So if you can instead pick a couple of words, put those together, now I've got a correct horse battery staple. I don't have to have special characters. I don't have to get crazy with the case. But it, computationally, it's just as hard or harder for a bad guy to guess and easier for you to remember, right? And we've got trade-offs here. I want you guys to remember good passwords and not get compromised and lose your information, right? So we see common bad passwords like this. Here's our top 20 most common bad passwords. Also on the list, we'll see like password 1, password 2, company name 1. Company name 2, things like this. And I, as a pen tester, I, as an ethical hacker, will go into organizations, try these passwords, and I don't need to get all of the users. I need 1. And that gets me the foothold. That also gets the bad guy the foothold. And once they're in the organization, they can start ripping the data out of the organization and causing a loss, right? Another example of bad passwords is this. Yeah, there's some debate whether this is actually true or not. But yeah, the nuclear launch codes was 10 zeros. And the rationale was, is there so many things on the checklist, this was at the very, very end, and they didn't want people to get too nervous and not enter the codes, so they just made it a whole bunch of zeros so they couldn't screw it up. Yeah, that's not terrifying. It was only like that for a decade with nukes, right? No damage can be caused by that. Talking about the password reuse. What bad guys will do is they'll compromise one location, they'll find your email address and a password, and they'll start using it in other places. This is a notification I've got from Pandora. Now, if I lose access to my Pandora account, I don't care in the slightest, right? It's my music. Someone's going to change like my Metallica station and add some Britney Spears to it. Right? I mean, it's awful, but worse things could happen, right? But they're notifying me and saying, hey, we saw in some other breach your email address and a password you use was compromised. If you use it here, you might want to change it. Okay, so it's important to use these unique passwords because if they breach your password in some insensitive location, they might then use that password in a location where it actually does hurt. So we want to make sure that we don't reuse those passwords. I don't have a good memory. I'm not good at coming up with new random passwords, and frankly, most people aren't. That's why I'm employed. So I use tools like 1Password or LastPass. There's a number of other tools out there as well. What these things can do, these applications can do, is they can generate a password for me. They can fill in the forms for me. And I can also, with a lot of these, I can carry it with me. So I've got it on my laptop, but I also have it in my pocket. So if I'm traveling and I need to access site fill in the blank, I can carry it with me. So it solves a lot of these problems. I'm not reusing the same password. I've got a good random password. In fact, I don't have to remember as much. I literally know, and my job is security, and I have access to machines all over the world, I know exactly 4 passwords. I know the one to get into my Gmail account. I know the one to unlock my 1Password when it locks. I know the one for my home router, and there's probably another one I forgot. Oh, the decryption password for my laptop. That's it. That's my 4th one. That's it. Everything else I store inside of here because it makes it a lot easier for me. It takes that burden off me, and it helps me not reuse passwords and helps me come up with good passwords. Something else that's important, backups. Okay, this is important for your business. If your business doesn't have a backup, what's going to happen if all the data disappears? Now, me as a, you know, the average home user, what's important to me? Pictures of my kids, you know, my tax stuff, that's important to me. I want to make sure that I don't lose this. And there's a number of different ways this could happen, right? Somebody could bust into my house, grab my laptop, and leave with it. I could have the drive fail on a device. A fire. We also have the newer threat, ransomware. I'll come back to the ransomware in just a second. So here's what, right now. So this is what we see with ransomware. What ransomware, this is the olden days when you would get some sort of malware on your system. It would steal your passwords, try to get your bank credentials. What we're seeing these days is you'll get some bad software on your system. What it does is it will encrypt all of your files, and it'll say, pay us or you don't get it back. And on top of that, they added a time frame. It's like, you got 5 days. The clock starts right now. And if at the end of 5 days you don't pay, on day 6 you decide to, they're like, nope, sorry, you're done. So they add a sense of urgency to it so that you can't figure out, oh, do I have backups? Can I decrypt any of this stuff? Do I actually need it? They add that sense of urgency. Frankly, it's sort of brilliant marketing. Here it costs $550 to decrypt your drive. And a lot of people will end up paying this. But if you have good backups, you don't have to do this. You simply wipe the machine, copy your files back. Now, it's important with those backups that they are not connected to your device. Because if they're connected, let me skip here real quick. You want multiple copies of your data. If your data, if you've got multiple copies and it's all on the same system, guess what happens when the ransomware strikes? It's all gone because it's all on the same system. So we got the 3-2-1 rule. 3 copies of your data, 2 different storage media, so not 3 copies on the same drive, and 1 offsite. By the way, I've got a copy of these slides. I'll give you guys a link at the end. You can download the whole thing. It makes it easier than taking pictures. 1 of them offsite. And I typically recommend the cloud. My backup strategy is a little bit more complicated because I'm a techie guy. I've got ways to store my information off-site that it's unsubpoenaable because of the way I encrypt and such. But there's a lot of other options we've got as well, like Crash Plan is a really good one for Windows. If you've got a Mac, Time Machine is pretty good. But back up that data, right? You don't want to lose those moments from your kids' birthday parties that you recorded with your iPhone. The tax information, yeah, you can probably get some of that back. Business information, you don't want to lose all of that. It can cost you, you know, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of dollars if that information disappears, right? So the ransomware, ideally, we would like to have the backups so we don't perpetuate this. The reason that ransoms exist is people pay for it. If people stop paying, these guys go away, but they've got a very viable economic strategy and they make good amounts of money doing this. They're running down your system, $550 isn't terrible, and you pay and move on. If they figure out you are a large business, that number goes up. If they figure out, you know, you're a hospital with millions of dollars of resources, that number goes up. On top of that, this ransomware, they don't necessarily always give you your information back. There's a new thing called ransomware. To actually write this ransomware takes some really solid developers. But what these, what we call script kiddies, people who aren't as good at writing the code will do is they'll say, oh, yeah, we're going to make our stuff look like ransomware, and instead, we're just going to delete the files because it's too hard to encrypt the files. So you pay them, and your information is still gone. So make sure that you get those solid backups so that you don't lose this information, and we're not funding the bad guys. Right? Another important thing, and you've probably all heard this before, updates. It's important to update your stuff. A tip, though, and this, because this is a way that a lot of people get infected, is they browse to a website, something pops up in their browser and says, your such and such is out of date. You should update. And what some people will do is they click on that, and that's where the initial point of compromise starts. Right? So it's a little bit difficult. I'm not going to pretend that this is easy. Long and the short of it is, if you go to a website and the website tells you something is wrong, never ever trust your browser. If your OS, and it's kind of hard sometimes to tell the difference, if your OS tells you to do updates, do the updates. If your phone tells you to do updates, do the updates. If you've got an Android device, you don't have to worry about that because you don't get updates. It's a problem with the Android marketplace. There's a whole problem with the infrastructure. There's multiple tiers, blah, blah, blah. Long and the short, you don't get updates. So the security vulnerabilities will last for a very long time. We also have a problem with our Internet of Things. You guys got the Internet of Things things at home? You guys heard that term before? A few of you? It's all the crap you have at home that's connected to the Internet. In front of polite company, it's referred to as Internet of Things. At our hacking conferences, it's iOS, and you can fill in the blank. Because it's all this random garbage. There was my friend of mine and I, Josh Wright, we did a talk at a conference in November of last year. We went on Amazon and spent about $400 buying random stuff that connects to the internet. We had an internet-connected coffee pot. We had an internet-connected crock pot, which, why you need to internet connect a crock pot, I don't get. Like, the entire point of a crock pot is I turn it on in the morning, I don't touch it, I come back 9 hours later, it's done. Right? You don't need to modify that thing, whatever. We had a camera and we had a doll. And we found different ways to exploit these things. The doll was pretty creepy because the doll was actually a bug. I could listen to the child talk to it. In fact, I could also speak back through the doll. That one, frankly, kept me up at night a little bit. These other devices, different issues, but they don't get updated. So we'll find a security vulnerability in it, and people are like, yeah, that product we're not selling anymore. We don't make money on it. Why should we actually update the device, right? Another important thing, be careful what you click on. Right? You've all heard this before. The sort of the big thing here is email. Phishing is huge. Phishing with a PH. Huge. The Verizon Data Breach Report puts that as one of the top things for compromise of organizations and people. And this isn't the broken English guy from Nigeria that has $1 million if you only send him $10,000 to release it from customs. Right? These are sometimes very skilled attackers who will target an organization. If your organization has, you know, $1 million worth of assets, money floating around, more than that, that's huge to people in these smaller countries. And if they can spend a little bit more time writing a very specific email targeting you, you're going to be in trouble. People will click on stuff and do stuff in email all of the time. As a pen tester, we'll do these phishing schemes. So there was one organization, we were doing phishing, and we decided, and the phishing scam, we were going to do a phishing scam internally to this organization and say, hey, why don't you take a survey about how to detect phishing. So we sent him this email. It's like, okay, you have to. It's a requirement by HR that you complete this phishing survey and make sure that you pass it. So we sent him information in, like, so you should verify the sender. You should do blah, 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 blah. At the very end, it said you have to authenticate and type in your username and password. And people were just sending us credentials. We literally were getting them too fast, and it was crashing some of our stuff. So be very, very, very careful. Email, be very, very careful. The phone apps, people don't think about that these days. Like, oh yeah, you know, I downloaded it from the Apple App Store. I'm safe. And by and large, on the Apple side, you are. The Android side's a little bit iffier, right? So we got, you know, the bad guys trying to get your information, and they're trying to make the information, trying to make what they're asking for appear legitimate so that you give them the information, credit card information, account information, and they're pretty good at it. They don't need everybody to fall for it. They need a few. The percentage of people that actually buy, like, the Viagra off of the websites and stuff is minuscule. I think it's 0.01%. But behind that, they actually have really good infrastructure to deliver the specific products. I talked about ransomware a little bit ago. Any of you guys ever call for tech support to your, like, ISP and stuff like that? How's your experience with that? Awful, isn't it? It's terrible. You dread doing it. You probably just give up and say, well, I'll come back later and deal with it some other point in time. Right? I'll talk to my nephew. He's a nerd. Right? We'll call up Tim and ask him, how do I fix this thing? The behind-the-scenes infrastructure for these bad guys is incredibly, incredibly professional. So we talked about the ransomware. They'll sell kits to infect people, and they have a warranty behind it. They have a help desk and support and contact people. If you call up and say, hey, I'm trying to send you money to decrypt my system, I need to get the Bitcoins to you, they will work with you, tell you where the closest location where you can get Bitcoins, help you with the transaction. They are really, really good at it. In fact, businesses in the U.S. could take a really good look at what the bad guys are doing and up their game. It is incredibly, incredibly professional and really serious stuff. Right? So here's one of our examples of our phishing email. Some of the obvious things to look for. You can't read all of it from where you are. But look at the domain. Right? This says mamazoncanada.ca. That should be like the first flag. Right? That it's not from Amazon. Another important thing is it says, dear generic person. I want my first name and my last name, and I want it to be spelled correctly. Ideally includes maybe like my account number, some other sort of sensitive information that nobody else should have unless it's already compromised. Also, if we look at our link here, that link's a little bit shady, right? Well, if we look closely, it says like Amazon.com, blah, 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 but if you mouse over it, it actually says something else. Okay, so we sort of look at a couple of these different cues. The long and the short of it is, in email, they should never, ever, ever ask you to click on links or give them information. The companies screw this up all the time, but ideally, you should never give any information that was requested via email from some company like this. If you expect, you know, you've got like a business associate and you expect to get the information, that's cool. You can also call them up and say, hey, is this actually you? That's perfectly fine as well, right? So when it comes to our apps, this is actually taken from a piece of malware from the Google Play Store. Anybody here an Android developer? I didn't think so. All right. So we're going to do this a little bit right here. So at the very top, in the blue, which says, okay, so we got the very first line, it says, error, Android version is not compatible. And right after that, it says, show. So on the screen, it's going to show Android device not compatible. Right below that, it says, get SIM country ISO. Now, none of you guys are programmers, but if you had to guess, what do you think that line of code might be doing? Getting the country code, right? I'm teaching you guys how to hack stuff, all right? You can do incident response and make good money. So again, get SIM country ISO. Next, if string 1 equals FR, where's FR? France, right? If in France, we've got a number and some text. Now, we've all seen, that's why I'm in IT, because I'm not very athletic. Yeah. We've all seen like the sad Sarah McLachlan songs, right? You know, like the puppy's missing an eye and a leg, and if you text money, we can buy him an eye and a leg, right? So what the bad guys are doing is they use these short codes so they'll infect your device, have you text message, and send them money. They get that money immediately. When do you detect the money is gone? When you get your bill, a month later. By that time, they're long gone in Tahiti, right? So we got the number, we got the text here that says star, and then it says there's four lines that are identical. Send SMS message. Guess what that line of code does? Sends the text message. You guys got this. You're Java developers. You too can develop crappy applications. Okay? So it sends the text message to 81001, the text star, four times. Each time it's sent, the bad guy gets $10. And you lose $10. Now, this particular bad guy, he wanted to keep track of, because this is actually goes to organized crime. So organized crime will set up these numbers, and they'll say, you guys get information, you guys get people to text this, and we'll give you a cut of it. Well, this author wanted to make sure that he wasn't getting screwed. So what he did off to the right is he says, get message body. If the message comes from at the very bottom, or wait, where is it? If the response is for like 81001 and a few other numbers, so if I text the sad Sarah McLachlan thing, I get a text back that says, hey, thanks for, you know, buying a leg for the puppy, right? Same thing happens with the bad guys. If I send the text, it's like, hey, congratulations, thank you for donating money to blah, 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 blah. What we can do on the Android side with L and earlier is we can suppress the message. So if a response comes back from 8001, which we saw up in the top left, we see abort message. We don't show that. And then he texts. What do you think that bottom blue text is there right there? Then it says, send text message. That's his number, right? So four text messages go out. They get $10 a pop. And he gets an alert that, hey, someone texted. But it's not his number. It was his mom's number. True story. So this is in France. A buddy of mine, his sister moved to France, called up his sister and said, hey, we've got to call this number. So they call this number. They get this lady. Josh is talking to his sister. His sister's talking to this lady. And they're going back and forth. And this lady finally's like, yeah, I've been getting all these text messages. I don't know what's going on. And finally, Josh reveals to his sister, who then reveals to the lady in French, oh, by the way, your son's in bed with, you know, organized crime, and he's stealing money from all sorts of people. Have you guys ever watched A Christmas Story? I love that movie, right? You guys remember the scene when, like, Ralphie drops the F-bomb, right? And then they call the friend. Like, you know, Ralphie said the bad word. He said, when they cover the thing, it's like, where did he learn that from? Well, probably from his father. And then the kid gets the crap beat out of him. That happened over the phone in French. My buddy's like dying laughing. He's like, well, maybe it's not okay. Maybe it is. But ultimately, this kid ended up going to jail and getting a couple of years in prison for his part in the cybercrime. All right? So I wanted to give you guys a couple of quick tips here on things that you can do to make yourself a little bit more secure. Maybe give you a little bit of background. What kind of questions do you guys have? Yes, sir. Shout it out. I'll repeat if I can hear you. So his question is, what do I have recommendations for backup for businesses? It depends on the size. Some of this stuff, this doesn't quite scale as much. Crash Plan actually has an enterprise option. To be perfectly honest, I haven't used that. But if you're of decent size, what a lot of organizations do you have any sort of dedicated IT staff, out of curiosity? No, okay. So in that case, something like Crash Plan Pro might be good for you, where you can distribute it across multiple systems, get that information off-site, so that if you do have, God forbid, a disaster, or one of these compromises, that you don't lose all of that data. Cool. Other questions? Two-factor authentication, what do I think about it? I use it a lot. So what we mean by two-factor authentication is there's sort of three ways to authenticate. Something I know, a password, right? There's something I have, which is like my phone. Or you guys remember like maybe those RSA tokens with the scrolling numbers. And there's also something that I am, like some sort of biometric. Two-factor authentication means we use two of those. And typically what we'll have is we'll have a password with something that I have. So what I do to authenticate to my Google account is I've got a password. It's one of the four passwords I remember, but I also have to have my phone. And I'll open up the app, and there's a number that changes every 60 seconds. And I have to enter that number to get in. And I'll use that for Google. I use that for Facebook. I use that for some of my code that I write when I push it to repository, because I want to make sure that I'm not, you know, leaking my information to someplace else, you know, getting our code compromised. Long and the short of it is, if you can use it, I would suggest doing so. It's not too bad. And to be perfectly honest with you, you can have that really long, complex password get a little bit simpler because you've got this additional layer with it as well. Does it answer your question?
I have another question.
Sure, follow up. How do you keep someone from walking out of your building with all of your information? That is exceedingly hard. Usually what we do, that's a long discussion in itself. Usually in that case, you end up doing detection. Like, hey, something, you can't necessarily catch them as they walk out, but maybe you figure out, hey, this person downloaded a whole bunch of stuff and they walked out of the building with it. And you can hopefully catch them relatively quickly afterwards. To do that, usually requires some sort of security team, some additional tools for what a product called DLP, data leak prevention, so they can see, is someone accessing too much information? Are they copying it onto some sort of target media that I don't trust? And then get it that way. If you're a smaller organization, I don't know of a great way to do it. The big thing is just restricting access. Consider the data toxic. Only let the people that need to get access to it get access to it. It's easy for me to say as the security guy, right? As a security guy, I don't help you make money, do I? I help you not lose money, ideally, but I'm a bump in the road. I make your life a little bit bigger of a pain. So trying to balance that is pretty tough, especially when you're a smaller organization. Frankly, I don't have a good answer for you if you are a smaller organization. Great. Yes, ma'am. So how do I set up the two-factor authentication with Gmail? So if you go to Google and Google for two-factor authentication, Google, if you go to like the settings, authentication, you'll download an application, you'll pick up your phone, you'll scan something on the screen, and it'll show you like a six-digit number that'll scroll every so often. It's a really, really cool feature.
Do you like Carbonite?
Carbonite is fantastic as well. Yeah. I only had so much screen space. Yes?
How dangerous is public Wi-Fi?
That's an interesting one. So I spend a lot of time in hotels. I'm going to be in Vegas this week at DEF CON, like I talked about. I will not use public Wi-Fi there. But how dangerous is it? I haven't seen a lot of breaches definitively tied back to that. So that's sort of a hard part. One thing that's helped us recently is we've moved a lot of our websites and services to HTTPS. We call that technically TLS, SSL. It's encrypted, so that helps us. But there's still lots of sent in the clear. There's some issues with the session negotiation up front, some more technical stuff. Just be careful. Okay. The answer that I use, if I connect to a public Wi-Fi, I'll usually VPN into my house. Okay, and there's a lot of those public services that are available to you. Frankly, my home router configures this for me. I've got a more expensive home router. It says, put this information in. Give it a username, give it a password, and it's all set up. Of course, I'm a techie guy, so it's a little bit easier. Also, if you've got like an iron key, not as commonly used these days, but it's an encrypted USB stick. They're not very big, but you can use that and you can tunnel back through IronKey. There's also additional services you can sign up for where I can buy a VPN and go back out through something else. Now, that target organization will see all of your information that's in the clear, but at least you get off the hotel network. And what you'll see sometimes is, you know, it's really easy with off-the-shelf hardware just to watch other people's web traffic. And hypothetically, I might do that when I'm bored in hotel rooms sometimes. People look at really weird stuff when they're in hotel rooms by themselves for a long period of time. Just saying, bring some eye bleach. Yes, sir. Correct. Yeah, so you want to have at least the second and third one sort of blend together. What you don't want is, okay, I've got three copies of the data. Great, it's all on the same disk. It doesn't do you any good, right? You would like to have maybe one copy more easily accessible. I mean, you could maybe be on the same disk, but you really want to get one copy out. So if you have a fire, if you have theft, if you have a compromise on your local network and everything gets encrypted, it's off, it's safe, people can't touch it. Does that answer your question? I think so, I can't see him. Question in the back first. Yes. So when we came, so his question is related to, we've got AV on our laptops and such. Why don't we have that on our mobile devices? And there's a fundamental change. We've had these problems with computers because each application on your computer is able to talk to all of the other applications, read all of the data on your computer. From a security point of view, that's horrible. I don't want that. So when we came up with these tablets and phones, we essentially got a reboot. We can say, hey, you know what? We're starting from scratch. We can put these things in all their separate containers. We call it sandboxing. So one application sits over here. It can't talk to the other thing. It can blow itself up, but it can't talk to anything else. So there's a lot of the protections in the operating systems that we don't have with our full-fledged computers. And that's the fundamental security thing. If you want to go to like the single most secure and commonly used operating system on the face of the planet, iPhone and the iPads, no question. There's a reason that the FBI was paying $1 million, willing to pay $1 million to get access to that phone, because it's really, really hard to do. A Windows exploit that will compromise a Windows box sells for about $250,000 at the very top end. The iPhone, four times that. Android, I think, is about $20,000, maybe. There's so many problems with Android. Did that answer your question? Yes, no question. His question is it safer to do it on my phone versus my computer? I would say no question, your iPhone is more secure than your computer, without a doubt. Yeah, there's all sorts of additional protections in place. The operating system is way more secure. Do you have a Windows or a Mac at home? Windows, okay. Windows is actually really good with security. iOS is number one. Windows is arguably the second one. The reason that we see so many problems with Windows is because that's what everybody has, and that's what the bad guys spend their money on. So they work really hard. It's sort of the analogy, what's more secure, a tank in downtown Baghdad or an unlocked car in the middle of the woods, right? Windows is that tank in downtown Baghdad. It is a super secure device, but everybody is trying to blow that sucker up. Whereas my Mac is arguably the least secure operating system on the face of the planet. It's the car in the middle of the woods.
We have time for one more question.
Do you store, is it good to store all your sensitive files in Dropbox? Is that safe? Yeah, that's not bad. The only issue you could potentially have there is with versioning. So if I have a file that's compromised and I'm actively connected to Dropbox, so if I get hit with ransomware and the ransomware encrypts that file, that will automatically sync to Dropbox, and now Dropbox has my encrypted file, and that's it. So you need that versioning somewhere. Can we sneak in one more? Go for it. So how do I personally compute with my home? I use Wi-Fi at my house. If you set your Wi-Fi up with a good password, a good passphrase, you're pretty reasonably secure. Yeah, it's the open networks. It's the Starbucks that can be potentially be bad. Cool. Let me turn it back over. Oh, yes. Let me. Stupid animations. There we go.
Hey, everybody. Let's give Tim another round of applause. Hey, I don't know about you guys, but I have a little running list of things that I need to do when I leave here and some passwords I need to change. And I'm just thankful I don't have an Android. So feeling good about the iPhone. You guys enjoy the rest of the trade show. And thanks again, Tim.
Thank you.